Chapter 3, Section 9 I had only just lifted my leg over the high barrier across the bottom of a gateway when suddenly a strong hand clutched at my chest. "Who's this?" roared a voice. "A friend or an enemy? Own up!" "He's one of us, one of us," Liputin's voice squealed nearby. "It's Mr. G, a young man of classical education, in touch with the highest society."
"I love him if he's in society, that means he's highly educated. The retired Captain Ignat Lebyadkin at the service of the world and his friends, if they're true ones, the scoundrels."
Captain Lebyadkin, a stout, fleshy man over 6 feet in height, with curly hair and a red face, was so extremely drunk that he could scarcely stand up before me, and articulated with difficulty. I had seen him before, however, in the distance. "And this one," he roared again, noticing Kirillov, who was still standing with the lantern. He raised his fist, but let it fall again at once. "I forgive you for your learning. Ignat Lebyadkin, highly educated. A bomb of love with stinging smart exploded in Ignati's heart. In anguish dire I weep again, the arm that at Sevastopol I lost in bitter pain." Not that I ever was at Sevastopol, or ever lost my arm, but you know what rhyme is. He pushed up to me with his ugly, tipsy face. "He is in a hurry. He is going home," Liputin tried to persuade him. "He'll tell Lizaveta Nikolaevna tomorrow." "Lizaveta," he yelled again, "stay, don't go." A variation. "Among the Amazons a star upon her steed she flashes by, and smiles upon me from afar, the child of aristocracy, to a starry Amazon." You know that's a hymn. It's a hymn if you're not an ass. The duffers, they don't understand. Stay. He caught hold of my coat, though I pulled myself away with all my might. "Tell her I am a knight and the soul of honor, and as for that Dasha, I'd pick her up and chuck her out. She's only a serf. She daren't." At this point he fell down, for I pulled myself violently out of his hands and ran into the street. Liputin clung on to me. "Alexei Nilitch will pick him up. Do you know what I've just found out from him?" he babbled in desperate haste. "Did you hear his verses? He sealed those verses to the starry Amazon in an envelope and is going to send them tomorrow to Lizaveta Nikolaevna, signed with his name in full. What a fellow!" "I bet you suggested it to him yourself." "You'll lose your bet," laughed Liputin. "He's in love like a cat. And, you know, it began with hatred. He hated Lizaveta Nikolaevna at first so much for riding on horseback that he almost swore aloud at her in the street. Yes, he did abuse her. Only the day before yesterday he swore at her when she rode by. Luckily, she didn't hear. And suddenly, today, poetry. Do you know he means to risk a proposal? Seriously, seriously." "I wonder at you, Liputin. Whenever there's anything nasty going on, you're always on the spot, taking a leading part in it," I said angrily. "You're going rather far, Mr. G. Isn't your poor little heart quaking, perhaps, in terror of a rival?" "What?" I cried, standing still. "Well, now to punish you, I won't say anything more. And wouldn't you like to know, though? Take this alone, that lout is not a simple captain now, but a landowner of our province. And rather an important one, too, for Nikolai Vsevolodovitch sold him all his estate the other day, formerly of 200 serfs, and as God's above, I'm not lying. I've only just heard it, but it was from a most reliable source. And now you can ferret it out for yourself. I'll say nothing more. Goodbye." Section 10 Stepan Trofimovitch was awaiting me with hysterical impatience. It was an hour since he had returned. I found him in a state resembling intoxication. For the first 5 minutes at least, I thought he was drunk. Alas, the visit to the Drozdovs had been the finishing stroke. "Mon ami, I have completely lost the thread. Lise, I love and respect that angel as before, just as before, but it seems to me they both ask me simply to find out something from me. That is, more simply to get something out of me and then to get rid of me. That's how it is." "You ought to be ashamed," I couldn't help exclaiming. "My friend, now I am utterly alone. Enfin, c'est ridicule. Would you believe it? The place is positively packed with mysteries there, too. They simply flew at me about those ears and noses and some mysteries in Petersburg, too.
You know, they hadn't heard till they came about the tricks Nicholas played here 4 years ago. You were here, you saw it. Is it true that he is mad? Where they got the idea, I can't make out. Why is it that Praskovya is so anxious Nicholas should be mad? The woman will have it so, she will. Say Maurice, or what's his name, Mavriky Nikolaevich, brave homme tout de même. But can it be for his sake, and after she wrote herself from Paris to cette pauvre amie? Enfin, this Praskovya, as cette chère amie calls her, is a type. She's Gogol's Madame Box of immortal memory. Only she's a spiteful Madame Box, a malignant box, and in an immensely exaggerated form. Well, that's making her out a regular packing case, if it's an exaggerated form. Well, perhaps it's the opposite. It's all the same, only don't interrupt me, for I'm all in a whirl. They are all at loggerheads, except Lisa. She keeps on with her auntie, auntie. But Lisa's sly, and there's something behind it, too. Secrets. She has quarreled with the old lady. Cette pauvre auntie tyrannizes over everyone, it's true. And then there's the governor's wife, and the rudeness of local society, and Karmazinov's rudeness, and then this idea of madness, c'est l'hypoutine, c'est que je ne comprends pas, and they say she's been putting vinegar on her head, and here are we with our complaints and letters, oh, how I have tormented her, and at such a time, je suis un grand. Only imagine I come back and find a letter from her. Read it, read it. Oh, how ungrateful it was of me. He gave me a letter he had just received from Varvara Petrovna. She seemed to have repented of her stay at home. The letter was amiable but decided in tone and brief. She invited Stepan Trofimovitch to come to her the day after tomorrow, which was Sunday at 12 o'clock, and advised him to bring one of his friends with him. My name was mentioned in parenthesis. She promised on her side to invite Shatov as the brother of Darya Pavlovna. You can obtain a final answer from her. Will that be enough for you? Is this the formality you were so anxious for? Observe that irritable phrase about formality. Poor thing, the friend of my whole life. I confess the sudden determination of my whole future almost crushed me. I confess I still had hopes, but now, tu as dit, I know now that all is over. C'est terrible. Oh, that Sunday would never come and everything would go on in the old way. You would have gone on coming, and I'd have gone on here. You've been upset by all those nasty things Liputin said, those slanders. My dear, you have touched on another sore spot with your friendly finger. Such friendly fingers are generally merciless and sometimes unreasonable. Pardon, you may not believe it, but I'd almost forgotten all that nastiness. Not that I forgot it, indeed, but in my foolishness, I tried all the while I was with Lisa to be happy and persuaded myself I was happy. But now, oh, now I'm thinking of that generous, humane woman, so long-suffering with my contemptible failings. Not that she's been altogether long-suffering, but what have I been with my horrid, worthless character? I'm a capricious child with all the egoism of a child and none of the innocence. For the last 20 years she's been looking after me like a nurse, cette pauvre auntie, as Lise so charmingly calls her. And now, after 20 years, the child clamors to be married, sending letter after letter, while her head's in a vinegar compress, and, now he's got it, on Sunday I shall be a married man, that's no joke. And why did I keep insisting myself? What did I write those letters for? Oh, I forgot. Lisa idolizes Darya Pavlovna, she says so anyway. She says of her, c'est un ange, only rather a reserved one. They both advised me, even Praskovya didn't advise me though, oh, what venom lies concealed in that box. And Lisa didn't exactly advise me. What do you want to get married for, she said. Your intellectual pleasures ought to be enough for you. She laughed. I forgive her for laughing, for there's an ache in her own heart. You can't get on without a woman, though, they said to me. The infirmities of age are coming upon you, and she will tuck you up, or whatever it is. Ma foi, I've been thinking myself all this time I've been sitting with you that Providence was sending her to me in the decline of my stormy years, and that she would tuck me up, or whatever they call it. Enfin, she'll be handy for the housekeeping. See what a litter there is. Look how everything's lying about. I said it must be cleared up by this morning, and look at the book on the floor. La pauvre amie was always angry at the untidiness here. Ah, Now I shall no longer hear her voice. Vingt-un, and it seems that they've had anonymous letters. Only fancy, it's said that Nicolas has sold Lebyadkin his property. C'est un monstre. Et enfin, what is Lebyadkin? Lisa listens and listens. Oh, how she listens. I forgave her laughing. I saw her face as she listened, and c'est Maurice. I shouldn't care to be in his shoes now. Brave homme tout de même. But rather sly, but never mind him. He paused. He was tired and upset, and sat with drooping head, staring at the floor with his tired eyes. I took advantage of the interval to tell him of my visit to Filipov's house, and curtly and dryly expressed my opinion that Lebyadkin's sister, whom I had never seen, really might have been somehow victimized by Nicolas at some time during the mysterious period of his life, as Liputin had called it, and that it was very possible that Lebyadkin received sums of money from Nicolas for some reason, but that was all. As for the scandal about Darya Pavlovna, that was all nonsense. All that brute Liputin's misrepresentations, that this was anyway what Alexei Nilitch warmly maintained, and we had no grounds for disbelieving him. Stepan Trofimovitch listened to my assurances with an absent air, as though they did not concern him. I mentioned, by the way, my conversation with Kirillov, and added that he might be mad. "He's not mad, but one of those shallow-minded people," he mumbled listlessly. "Ces gens-là supposant la nature et la société humaine autre que Dieu ne les a faites et qu'elles ne sont réellement. People try to make up to them, but Stepan Verkhovensky does not, anyway. I saw them that time in Petersburg avec cette chère amie. Oh, how I used to wound her then. And I wasn't afraid of their abuse or even of their praise. I'm not afraid now, either. Mais parlons d'autre chose. I believe I have done dreadful things. Only fancy, I sent a letter yesterday to Darya Pavlovna, and how I cursed myself for it. What did you write about? Oh, my friend, believe me, it was all done in a noble spirit. I let her know that I had written to Nicolas 5 days before, also in a noble spirit. I understand now, I cried with heat, and what right had you to couple their names like that? But, mon cher, don't crush me completely. Don't shout at me. As it is, I'm utterly squashed, like a black beetle. And after all, I thought it was all so honorable. Suppose that something really happened en Suisse, or was beginning. I was bound to question their hearts beforehand, that I, enfin, that I might not constrain their hearts and be a stumbling block in their paths. I acted simply from honorable feeling. Oh, heavens! What a stupid thing you've done, I cried involuntarily. Yes, yes, he assented with positive eagerness. You have never said anything more just. C'était bête, mais que faire, tu es dit. I shall marry her just the same, even if it be to cover another's sins. So there was no object in writing, was there? Oh, you're at that idea again. Oh, you won't frighten me with your shouts now. You see a different Stepan Verkhovensky before you now. The man I was is buried. Enfin, tu es dit. And why do you cry out? Simply because you're not getting married, and you won't have to wear a certain decoration on your head. Does that shock you again? My poor friend, you don't know woman, while I have done nothing but study her. If you want to conquer the world, conquer yourself. The one good thing that another romantic like you, my bride's brother Shatov, has succeeded in saying. I would gladly borrow from him his phrase. Well, here I am, ready to conquer myself, and I'm getting married. And what am I conquering by way of the whole world? Oh, my friend, marriage is the moral death of every proud soul, of all independence. Married life will corrupt me, it will sap my energy, my courage in the service of the cause. Children will come, probably not my own either, certainly not my own. A wise man is not afraid to face the truth. Liputin proposed this morning putting up barricades to keep out Nicolas. Liputin's a fool. A woman would deceive the all-seeing eye itself. Le bon Dieu knew what he was in for when he was creating woman, but I'm sure that she meddled in it herself and forced him to create her such as she is, and with such attributes, for who would have incurred so much trouble for nothing? I know Nastasya may be angry with me for free thinking, but enfin, tu es dit. He wouldn't have been himself if he could have dispensed with the cheap, jibing free thought which was in vogue in his day. Now, at any rate, he comforted himself with a jibe, but not for long. Oh, if that day after tomorrow, that Sunday, might never come, he exclaimed suddenly, this time in utter despair. Why could not this one week be without a Sunday? Si le miracle existe, what would it be to Providence to blot out one Sunday from the calendar, if only to prove his power to the atheists, et que tout soit dit? Oh, how I loved her! 20 years, these 20 years, and she has never understood me. But of whom are you talking? Even I don't understand you, I asked, wondering. Bon, oh, and she has not once understood me. Oh, it's cruel. And can she really believe that I am marrying from fear, from poverty? Oh, the shame of it. Oh, auntie, auntie, I do it for you. Oh, let her know, that auntie, that she is the one woman I have adored for 20 years. She must learn this. It must be so. If not, they will need force to drag me under que qu'on appelle le wedding crown. It was the first time I had heard this confession, and so vigorously uttered. I won't conceal the fact that I was terribly tempted to laugh. I was wrong. He is the only one left me now, the only one, my one hope, he cried suddenly, clasping his hands as though struck by a new idea. Only he, my poor boy, can save me now. And oh, why doesn't he come? Oh, my son, oh, my Petrusha! And though I do not deserve the name of father, but rather that of tiger, yet... Laissez-moi, mon ami, I'll lie down a little to collect my ideas. I'm so tired, and I think it's time you were in bed. Voyez-vous, it's 12 o'clock. End of chapter 3.